Thank you for the opportunity to speak here today in front of you. I wish it would be face to face, but we have to get used also to this online platform. So today I'd like to talk about nanophotonics at the Hebrew University. I will focus on the activity in my nanophotonics group, but of course there are other activities by other professors who are very active in the topic of nanophotonics. So let's just remind you about the quest for miniaturization. You can see here this Moore law that is showing that the number of transistors is actually doubled every year or so. And at the bottom right, you can see some of the vendors of chips. And you can see that they nowadays, in 2021, they can already come up with chips with features down to the 4-5 nanometer level. This is really amazing, a capability that we did not have before. And now, having in mind this capability on one hand, and keeping in mind the challenges and opportunities in optics, ranging from memory and storage of information and lithography and imaging and biomanipulation, biosensing, optical communication, optical information processing, energy harvesting, and of course nowadays also the field of automotive and autonomous cars. All these challenges are related to optics, and they can benefit from the capability of making tiny things at the nanoscale. We call this field nanophotonics, and the nanophotonics, both the science and the technology of nanophotonics, is actually a key to face all these challenges that I have listed here in the slide. So another motivation for the activity is coming from the internet, and you all know about the internet and the demand for higher and higher data rates, and you are all aware of something called data center, which actually store all our emails and route it from one place to another. So this is something that is growing up very, very fast over the years. you can see the growing rate of Google and Facebook. And there is only one little problem, scaling. This is a standard data center, and you can see just the number of cables. It's becoming insane, something that cannot be supported. And also not only the number of cables, it's also about heat that is being generated and data rate that cannot be supported by modern electronics. So there's a real problem here. And the solution for this problem is to use photonics, because you are aware that already photonics is routing information. We are running around the globe with optical fibers. So the best way to route information is by photonics. And indeed, data centers of today are already equipped with some photonics and optical fibers connecting between one rack and the other. So it's coming there. But there's still a huge problem. And the problem called the features, the fundamental features of photonics, there is something called diffraction limit. We cannot scale down optics in a similar way to electronics. Electrons can be squeezed to tiny dimensions of few nanometers, but photons cannot be squeezed to that dimension. We have something called diffraction limit, which is the order of the wavelengths, something around 1 micron, half a micron, and it's very difficult to go down beyond that. So there are a few equations here that explain, but basically the spot size, the minimal spot size of a beam of light is in the order of this wavelength, about 1 micron. So there's really a fundamental limit, how we can bridge the scale from the micron scale to the nanoscale. A few orders of magnitude that we have to come up. And that's where nanophotonics is coming. And as I mentioned, challenges are very high. You can see that, let's say, if we try to bend a beam of light very sharply, actually, the beam of light is not following this turn, like a car that is missing the turn and just goes straight. So same thing happens to photons. And also on the left graph, you can see that as we try to start to shrink the dimensions of the optical structures. At the beginning, yes, indeed, the mode, the size of the mode of light also goes down with the size of the physical structure. But at some point, there's a turning point, and we keep shrinking the size of the physical structure, but the optical mode actually cannot follow this squeezing, and it kind of expands, can the structure cannot support the optical mode anymore. So there's really a fundamental problem here where nanophotonics is in real need to solve this problem. So what is the vision? The vision is follow. Here is like a standard microelectronic chip, a modern one, and in contrast, here is a photonic system. Just I've taken some photo of my optical table. And of course, you can see the striking difference. So the idea is to take something like that, all this mass that we have on the optical table, and to convert it to something like that. This is the vision. That's what we are doing at the Hebrew University and also in some other places. And we have significant achievements along these lines. Let me just give you a snapshot of some of the structures and the ideas that we are looking at. So you can see something called silicon photonics, and these are like tiny, tiny waveguides, like wires for light that are sitting on a chip, very similar to electronics, and they are guiding light. So you can see some of these structures, they are all supporting light at the nanoscale. So these are some structures, some achievements coming from basic ideas that we had. Then we had to implement and fabricate those structures in the nano center of the Hebrew University. And finally, after these structures are being made, we go back to the lab and characterize, measure, and show that indeed these structures, they work as expected, and they provide the functionality that we are looking for. There's something else called metasurface. It's like a surface that we are controlling at the nanoscale in order to provide it with new features and new functionality. If you just take a surface, it's kind of very boring. There's reflection, refraction, some very standard rule of optics that control what's going on. But if you texture the structure, then a new world is becoming available to you. You can control the scattering of light. You can control the spectral properties, the polarization properties, amplitude phase, and all kinds of parameters that are super important for designer of photonic systems. So nanoscale provide new opportunities. you can see some kind of how these optical confinement effects take place. These are modes called magnetic dipole and electrical dipole. And all these modes are occurring at the nanoscale, supported by physical nanoscale structures made of silicon or some other materials. So you can see the vision, for example, taking a large lens and just squeeze it, make it one single plane of maybe 100 nanometer thick, no more than that. And these can be used for many, many use cases and applications. Just a nice structure that we have made recently, you can see a repeated structure, and that can be used for lensing application. And mentioning lens, let me show you what we are having in mind. So the idea is to take a very complicated lens that consists of many, many layers, and it's kind of thick, and replace it with a very tiny one. So you can see the gradual transition from, if you look at the bottom, you can see the gradual transition from the very left to the intermediate stage where it's becoming already more thin, and all the way down to the right where we really have a very, very thin element that can perform imaging very similar to these bulky lenses that you know today. So we have made one of these structures. I would not go into the details, but you can see at the bottom left some snapshot of the features that this lens is composed of. And as a result of making this lens, we have been doing some field tests. And what you see here is a real image. So we just took a standard camera and replaced the lens of the camera by our lens. And you can see the photo of some part of my research group in this system. And actually, it's the first ever outdoor photo with metal lenses. So people have demonstrated some things like that, but just within the lab where you have very strong laser light. But we have been using just ambient light from the sun, which is definitely more challenging, and that was the first ever result. And of course, the vision is to try to have these kind of lenses eventually going into the consumer market to cell phones and other miniature devices. Finally, let me show you one more activity related to nanophotonics and miniaturization. It has to do with precision measurements, metrology, for example, replacing the atomic clock. So what you see here is a standard state-of-the-art atomic clock that you can find, for example, at NIST in Boulder, Colorado in the United States. As you can see, it's quite bulky. And the idea is to be able to perform all navigation and accurate measurements on a chip. This is highly desired functionality, for example, for GPS navigation, timekeeping, measurements, all these kind of things that you want to do on a chip. And what we are working on for the last few years is taking all this huge structure and make it on a chip. And some of the recent results are summarized in these slides, just a very recent Nature Photonics paper that has been published and is explaining more about that. So with that, I think it's time to finalize the talk with acknowledging the funding agency that are supporting this research. And of course, I would like also to thank to the university and its management for supporting and providing us with the tools for the research. Thank you very much.